So the title of the presentation is called Nitrogen on Your Test Pyramid. And first of all, I have to thank you for attending to my talk today. So my name is Enrico Bruno Del Zotto. I'm working in London for a company that is called TUI and doing Android pretty much. So the final takeaway about this talk will be how to better organize your tests. I hope that I give you an overview about what we'll expect in the next year and in the manner in which you can better do testing and better cover your production code. So this talk is the natural continuation of the talk that I did last year in SAMDroidCons. So you can see the video online. So last year, just for a quick recap, we had an overview about different level of testing, how to organize this test on different layers. We spoke about unit integration and UI test, which frameworks we can use to cover this level. And different advantages and disadvantages on do testing same manner instead another one. I really suggest you to see the video. So just a quick recap on what we said. We spoke again about unit integration and end-to-end test in the different so different level of testing, different kind of coverage, different speed execution, and as well as different execution environment. Today in my talk, I will generally refer to test. I will not speak about different one kind of test, one, but I rather prefer to speak to refer to test like in general, because currently we have the Android test library that give us the possibility to test different layers using the same frameworks. So we are not talking about test and any one of these acronyms. And as we said before, the test library is composed by different layers and is pretty much that give us pretty much the possibility to test every level of our pyramid. So last year we finished our talk speaking about refactoring and why the UI tests are very important before starting this process. So again, the refactoring process and in a specific the coding refactoring is the process of changing our code, restructuring the existing stuff without changing the external behavior. This is a process that more or less, if you are a developer, you always either to face with, and of course with a lot of issue, hopefully not, especially when you have to deal with legacy code. So as I said last year, UI tests are very important before starting this process because you never had the full overview of the feature that you are refactoring. And before starting this process, is very important to have all the requirements covered by some test in order not to lose this stuff once the code is refactoring. So please, before to write some tests and not start the refactoring process where be arrogant and say that you know the feature that you are going to refactor because for sure you are missing something. So not you are not Chuck Norris, don't do it in production. when you are writing test and you spend some time on it, you will ask yourself, what is a good test? So what is the anatomy for a good test? For sure, when you write it, a good test should be self-descriptive. It means that when you open your class and you write the function or the method that you are going to be that is going to be executed, you will understand what is going to test, of course. The test should be simple, so you will not be you have not to pretend to cover a lot of cases, a lot of scenarios in a single test, and should be solid. What it means solid? Yes, solid is should follow the solid principles. So you will not expect to face with tests and with code very complex, and because of the code that you are writing in your test should be important, as well as the production code, as well as your business logic production code. And so in the same manner that you are writing it in the in your production environment, so you with the same you have to put the same attention in your test. So first of all, you have to use the KISS principle. So please, when you are writing your test before the refactoring process, try to keep it simple. Try to keep your test target. So don't try to cover multiple scenarios in the same test. So don't try to write something like that, in which you are trying to you don't understand. If you are faced with this code, it's difficult to understand what it's doing. It's difficult to understand what it's covering, and of course, it's very difficult to change if the flow of the app will change. So do not test multiple things. Test one thing at a time. And this is an example of UI test. In which you have a scenario, so you your test will be exactly the scenario. It will be exactly in that scenario. So in this case, we are launching a fragment and checking the location. And once the fragment is recreated, we are checking. We are doing our test. We are doing our assertion. So try to keep your test targeted and go directly in the scenario that you would like to test. So try to not repeat yourself, as in your code you don't want to have code replication. So if you have multiple scenario to test, if you have multiple test cases that should be done in your feature, try to extrapolate the code that in order to repropose this scenario in every function, every test. Try so to use abstraction on similar objects. So try to have some base cases, some base tests, and of course use the minimal dependencies. Your test, of course, in your test, you don't want to deal a lot with network, with data. You don't want to use multiple frameworks to make assertions. So your test, in short, should do only one thing. Drive the open the test scenario. Do the user action. So emulate the user action and assert that that action produce an effect or not. So in short, your test doesn't care about all the low-level stuff, all the manner in which you are mocking the network, the manner in which you are mocking your source data, the first data of true. The manner in which you are synchronizing threads. So the test would like to go directly to the scenario. And ignore everything about other layers. So keep your, this is why I always say to keep your test agnostic. So agnostic is something who doesn't know. This is why we need a level of abstraction. So we don't care about idling resources, asynchronous event, the manner in which the network is injected or mocked, etc. Of course, we would like to have the control over all this stuff. And so in the case, for example, of network calls, we would like to inject this this data in our application. We would like to mock it. And for example, in case of a synchronous event, I rather prefer not to use idling resources because idling resources are not deterministic. So I prefer to mock out events. So again, it means inject your data, synchronize the process if it needed, and of course do the test. So test the condition and use framework, frameworks to do the assertion. Truth in the case of assert of Android test library, or you can use assertj. And so inject your data is important. So try, if you use a good test design pattern in your app, it will be very easy to do. In my code examples, I used mock web server in order to mock data. This is an example when you are injecting, you can inject network code. Here we are creating our next network test module, and we have the control over all the network calls that we are firing in the emulator and the manner in which we are answering. So it is a good opportunity to experiment also this stuff, try to emulate not only the successful calls, but also errors, delays. I rather suggest you to take a look to the mock web server, and there are a lot of functionality that can mock a real network scenario. So as I said, also synchronize. We don't want, when we are testing, we don't want to care about background operations. Again, in our code, I rather prefer not to use idling resources, but rather than mock out the process, because idling resources are not deterministic. So it's are not under our control. So rather prefer to mock out resources instead of using idling. When you are doing your test, you pretend that the user is doing some actions. So again, when you are writing test, you don't want to you want to have an abstraction of what the user is doing. So in Android test library, we can use, for example, the activity scenario to launch activity, or using different frameworks. We don't want to deal the manner in which we are recreating activity, or the what is happening when the user is rotating the screen, but we can emulating it as I'm doing here. And after that, we have to do the real test. So test something and make an assertion. And again, there are a lot of essential frameworks that we can use. We can also build some abstraction over it using the truth of AsserJs. Here is an example of assertion of make some assertion on a recycled view item. But I mean, what is important is that currently we need a level of abstraction, because we would like to be ready to what Google is going to release. So again, what is Project Nitrogen? Project Nitrogen is an approach in order to run your test code more or less in every environment. It means you write once, you can run it everywhere. in Google Cloud, in emulated devices, in real emulator in your local environment, or in continuous integration. So last year we spoke a lot of the manner in which you can write your test using Espresso framework and run it not only in a real device, but also in the JVM using RoboElectric. This is one of the approaches that Nitrogen we would like to achieve. To be honest, I found a lot of issues using the same code, because I was we was fighting between a lot of incoherences between using the same code, for example, when the screen is rendered or when you are doing assertion in some shadow classes that RoboElectric is doing, and the behavior is not exactly the same. But of course, I think that is something that we have to fight with in the next year, when the Nitrogen will be released. As we can see in the Android J runner, something is moving. Here, for example, is a piece of code of the JUnit Runner 4, in which we can run our test in the emulator, or so using the normal Android JUnit or using the RoboElectric test runner, if the emulator is connected or not. And so in order to be prepared to this scenario, again, we would like to have a level of abstraction in our test. So we would like to write really our test once and not go back and change our code, because we need to fight with different frameworks, or we need to, or because we are finding incoherences between different, again, running environment. So what Uncle Bob says, he said that you have to keep your test code at the same level of quality of the production one. So the test code is not a throwaway code. So when you are writing your UI test, you would like again to write once. So covering a future scenario in which that can be useful in the future when you are coming back to and you would like, for example, to refactor the code. So I can suggest different patterns. Here is a very, very simple one. You have to think about that when you are writing your test, you will be always in the same in the kind of scenario in which you are given a scenario. So when you are approaching to a feature, when something is happening, when a user make an action, then you can make an assertion that this user action will produce some effect. Here I wrote a wrapper around this more or less concept, in which I used the mock web server in order to have a proper answer in the case when we are calling the network. And also use a class to emulate a user action. And when you are making an assertion, if you go deeper in the user assertions class, you can see that I'm using AsserJ or in some cases truth in a very simple manner. And this is a UI test written with this level of abstraction. It's very simple. And here again, given a test environment, for example, we are in the scenario of the login fragment when the user is writing something in this edit test. So in this case, he's writing his email and clicking login, then we can assert something. Here the code, to be honest, we have a lot of duplication, so it's not properly a good approach. So I have started to take a look to another pattern. And as well as in the production code, there are a lot of patterns also in the with test. We can meet other kind of approaches. ER is a famous one proposed by Jake Wharton. He, when he presented this speech, he spoke about the testing robots, which is a pattern that is based on the page object pattern. Later on, I can link you to this page. And this possible, and is written with the Kotlin domain language. It's very easy to be read, and it's very very simple to be extended. This is an example. Let's try to rewrite the test case that we had before. So here again, we are creating our robot in which we are doing some action, and we have the scenario of the login screen, and in the same manner that we tested before, and this is the same code written with a robot pattern, and there are benefits and drawbacks about this approach. The benefits are that the code is very readable, very simple to be extended, and of course is and is Kotlin, and well, if you are reading this code, is you can understand very well what the robot is doing. There are also drawbacks. So again, it's not very clear what is the state in which this test is starting. So, and also here we are explicitly saying what are the actions that the robot is doing. In this case, we are writing an email and clicking the login. But the assertions that we are doing are hidden in the lower level. So in which manner we can assert, and in which manner we can have a level of abstraction of an assertion. So again, as we said before, we don't want to fight with different frameworks. Last year, in my presentation, I showed you the case in which we can we have two different manner. We have the same assertion, but it's working on Espresso and failing on RoboElectric. We would like not to be again in that case. So let's try to see in which manner, manner we can have a better approach in this case, so in which manner we can make this assertion more explicit using the robot pattern. So I think that our production code architecture can help us in this case. So rather than that, if you are using MVP or MVVM or MVI, your test design pattern, you have to think your when you are writing your UI test, you have to always think about test your production design pattern in order to try to extrapolate what is the state of the application of the app that you are working with. So a time ago, I saw this presentation about Hans Dorfman, in which he was using an MVI approach, and I rather suggest you to take a look. And during his talk, he presented this manner to writing a UI test, in which is more or less the UI pattern with some benefit, with some other things, in which is explicitly asserting the state of the, in this case, of this scenario. And it's very interesting the manner in which he achieved to this result. So his architecture, is the pattern that he used is, was a state-based architecture, so in this case, model view intent, in which he explicitly defines a state, so the application can be in the loading, error state, etc. And the user can do some actions, And of course, the state is observable. So it's the application is based on a state machine, and this state machine has always a first source of truth, which in this case is a repository. And as we said before, the source of truth can be mocked in order to have to have the full control of what we are receiving. And the state of the screen are rendered using a viewbinder. And so, first of all, is injecting the first source of truth. In this case, creating the robot is injecting this test test repository, and is launching, is creating a scenario. As we said before, the test we would like to arrive directly to what we would like to test without writing a lot of code. And inside the robot, we have the state verifier that is verifying and asserting properly what is the rendered state and what is the state that is going to be rendered. And after that, in our robot, we can do our assertion, use the state verifier, verifying that the exposed state is what we would like to be. So in short, because of the state is very explicit, using the state verifier, we can assert in which state we are. Very explicit. So, and rendering the state is using, as I said, the viewbinder that is injected as dependency. This can bring a lot of benefit. This is one of them. For example, here is an extension of some viewbinder in which is every time that the state is changing. So every time that the view is rendered, or you can also use, for example, here a library to make a screenshot. And this is another level of abstraction. I mean, it's a huge benefit because you are writing your test, you don't care about what is going on in the background, and you would like also to have a proof of what is rendered in the screen. So, but I don't want to use the library directly in your test. This is a manner of this is a manner in which you can achieve this result. And again, this viewbinder is injected in the fragment in this manner. So I rather suggest you to take a look to the approach that is suggested, and I changed a bit in the code that I will share with you later on in my GitHub repository. And so again, when you are refactoring your code, you have to think about what are the acceptance criteria that is covering your feature. And so approaching to this process, if you have very well written UI tests, you can arrive to this scenario in which you are doing the refactoring, and you can expect that your UI tests are failing. You should do more refactoring in your code, going deeper to every unit of your code, so rewriting unit tests, and later on, without changing any line in your UI test, you have to expect that your UI tests are passing. So if you have your test suite that is very reliable, you can arrive to you can do the refactoring process in a proper manner. So when you are doing it, sometimes as I said before, try to reserve some time to write your test, and try to do your best before starting the refactoring in order not to arrive to a result in which your PR is will declined and put some stress in your team. So the approach, don't be so arrogant with yourself in order to pretend to know that you, because you have written a feature, you know everything. So before starting the refactoring process, do your UI test. And again, you would like to finish to arrive to a form like this in which everything is abstract and you arrive directly to the scenario testing what you would like to test and in a very fast manner, in a very explicit manner, and you don't want to care about the lower levels. So this is the final form in which I arrive using also the Dorfman approach. I will share with you later on in my GitHub profile the manner in which you can achieve this result. So I suggest you to spend some time in order to write a good test suite that you can reuse, when you are writing your code, when you are refactoring your code, and just to keep in mind that your test suite should be reliable, should be accurate, and should be fast. Reliable because, for example, I have to try to drive to the same scenario in one test using RoboElectric, using Espresso, and I fought with these different frameworks and was not very the same. I found a lot of differences, and of course should be fast. So you don't want to spend a lot of time to run your tests. And so now a quick recap of what we said in this talk. So end-to-end tests are very important and should cover the user journey in the app. And if you are covering this journey and you are covering the high level requirements, so what the user will see, so you are testing not the unit, you are testing the feature, you are testing what exactly the user will see. So I rather suggest you to choose one test design pattern that is that should be very close about your design architecture, and your production test code and the pattern that you have used in your production code can help you in order to achieve this result. And I rather suggest you, if you start a project from scratch, to keep in mind the test per design approach. So exposing explicitly the state of your app can be a huge benefit for you. As I showed you before, you can use different tricks in order to verify your state, drive the UI state, and make the assertion very explicit. So I would suggest you, if you start the project from scratch, to use this approach. And again, thanks everyone to attend to my talk. And now, if you have some question, let me come back here. All right. So sometimes UI tests with Espresso really flick. I mean, if you run test alone, it passes. And run a test suite, it migrate. How you deal with it? Right. So starting from the beginning. Right. Yes. So we have I wrote base test base class. I usually use some rules in order to clean scenario. To clean the environment before start doing the test in order to be sure that our environment is clean, especially, for example, if you are testing or you are doing something with your injected database. Rules can help you before starting the test. So cleaning the environment is very important. And I had sometimes the same cases. So I rather suggest you to use rules and clean your environment before the test is starting and when the test is ending. So this could be an approach for sure. Yeah. So let's go to the following one. So is there a place to track progress of project Nitrosm? How often do you run and do you sequence? Is there any place to track progress? No. Project Nitrosm is private. I had the possibility to have some, news from some people that is working in Google that they are working on it currently. It's passed the beta test. So it should be released hopefully this year, but I mean, I'm not working in Google and it's not public. The only news that we have what we saw in the 2018 Google I/O. There are some Google posts by in Medium written by Googlers, but nothing else. I rather suggest you to follow the Android test library commits, in which you can see that a lot of things are moving. And in the last year, I followed also RoboElectric repository, and you can see that they are working more or less together. And the proof is that the piece of code that I showed you in the JUnit runner. So, but explicitly, there is no place in which you can track the progress. So let's go to the following one. So how often do you run them? And do you execute always all of them? Because of the changes that I did, my experiment that I did last year, we had a lot of UI tests that is running in the continuous integration, so in the JVM environment. And we've covering a part of the app, especially the navigation, UI exception, and jumps. And because of those tests are very important for us, they are running every time in the continuous integration, every time that we are building the app and or producing an artifact. And the proper UI test, so the espresso test that currently are running in the emulator are covering the other part of the app, and we are running it in our local environment. So the most important UI test that are covering the important part of the app are running every time, and the other tests are running when we are, before do the commit, before push the commit, or, in our local environment. So not very often, to be honest, as I would like to, as it should be, but we try to, integrate, to have more integration in the future for this UI test, for sure. So, let's go to the following one. How long takes the continuous integration to run all the tests in your project unit integration and UI? Well, it depends on the variant that we are building. But more or less, if the machine is not, there are not a lot of, you know, process in our Jenkins, etc., we can expect that our unit test plus the UI tests that are running in a JVM, as I said before, we are not covering the full app, but we are covering only some cases of the app. And so we are running only one part of the UI test in JVM. So more or less it's taking 45 minutes. The other UI test, it depends in which scenario you would like to run, but it's more or less 1 hour. And well, if you are running in your local environment, if you would like to run with different machine, it takes more. So let's go to the follow one. Is there an easy way to inject the view model mock in your Fragment Espresso test? Well, again, is I rather prefer when what you mean inject a view model. So if you why you have to change your I think that in your view model you are writing your business logic, right? So why you would like to inject a view model mock in your Fragment Espresso? So it makes no sense for me. In the Fragment Espresso, you would like to test the higher level of what you wrote in the view model, so why you have to inject it. And so the view model should use, you know, the for example, a mocked source of truth, like, you know, network, like a network, like a mock network, or mocked database. But I don't see any sense to inject a view model in your Fragment, to be honest. So let's go to the other one. Do you run Espresso end-to-end test in parallel on CI? No. No. Again, we have to spend more time on this part. Currently, we had not a lot of the possibilities to do this stuff, but for sure in the future we will spend more time in which manner to optimize this stuff. So I hope in the next 6-7 months we will improve a lot our test suite, and in those cases we can solve our incoherences that we have between the tests that we are running in the JVM, so the test that we are running with using RoboElectric and the tests that are running in Espresso, and maybe running everything in the continuous integration. So in short, no. The end-to-end tests are running in the local environment currently, and the other tests, other UR tests are running in the continuous integration. So the following one, what thing can you suggest for developers to improve the speed of their test suites, especially for large projects? Well, to be honest, having, as I said in the presentation talk, having an instruction layer on what you are testing can be a huge improvement. So you have to be clear what you would like to test, the manner in which you are testing, and what you are what you are asserting. So having this thing clear can give you the possibility to separate the responsibility. So the test is doing the test, so like the business logic of the test, and later on you can concentrate of the manner in which you can improve the speed of your test, like, you know, drive the user or create, you know, launch a fragment, create an activity, make the rotation of the screen, etc. And well, a part of that, I rather suggest you to to run your UI test and in some cloud like the Firebase cloud, or of course try to attach your UI test in the continuous integration, so running in an environment in which there are already a lot of optimization in the case of hardware, etc. Don't pretend to have your own laboratory in which you are attaching multiple devices, etc. So from my point of view, I rather suggest you to use what you can find in the cloud, especially in the Firebase cloud. So I go to the following one. Do you have some tips to test UI with a live data? Well, again, in the UI, when you are doing the UI test, again, you should have a level of abstraction. You don't want to care about live data. You don't want to care about what you are observing and what you are exposing, et cetera, et cetera. So be very connected to something that you wrote in the view models or whatever. So you have to think that you are observing something that is rendered in the screen. So why you have to connect this to the live data? So I mean, from my point of view, live data is something that you can use in the view models or in another part of the app. Is not really connected to what you are UI testing. So in the MVVM approach, you are listening to something that can be observable, right? So live data is only another pattern that exposing this is another observable pattern that is not totally related to what you are UI testing. So, well, I have no tips, to be honest, on it. I just saying that maybe this question can be reformulated in which manner you can expose better your state, application state in the case of, you know, different patterns, or in this case of model view model. Well, there are different manners in which you can drive your application or your app in some scenario, and it's totally not related to the live data. Okay, so let's go to the following one. Do you agree with that end-to-end is very important as unit test? In the fact that with end-to-end tests, you discover more production bugs. I think that unit tests are very, very, very important. End-to-end tests are in cases more important than unit tests. Because in the end-to-end test, you are covering the user scenario, so the user journey in the app. So what the user is seeing in your application, and it's very important because it can be also not covering also the journey, but the what your feature is doing, what your app is doing. So, and this is a code that you write once, and if the flow of your application is not happening, you should have not to change. Unit tests are super important because it's covering a small portion of the code, but when you are refactoring or when you are touching the technology that you are using, or maybe if you are changing or some method inside your business logic, etc., without, you know, touching something outside in the requirements, you are expecting that your unit test is failing. So the end-to-end tests are very important from my point of view to discover production bugs, of course, and are important, of course, but are not very important, but I mean are important in different in a different manner, but important as well. So thank you for everything. I think if there is no other question, we can stop the streaming. And thanks for joining. If you have some other question, I'm in the Slack channel, and you can, you know, reach me in the Twitter or other channel. Thank you.